for 88. You suck.
At the Grand Concourse 149th Street Station in the Bronx, graffiti writers gather at what they call the writer's bench.
What's good, what's good, what's good? Live from the writer's bench. I'm your man Kill, back on tap with two of our usual suspects. What's good, Evan B?
Fish.
What up, what up?
That's what it is. Shout out to the homie Vic, who ain't with us tonight. But you know, it's good to be back. We took a little minute break.
Ooh. Okay.
What's that?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I should have did this sort of earlier. Pete Rock versus Primo.
Okay. Where you cop that from?
Actually from Pete Rock's site, man. Big shout out to Pete Rock. What it up? That, he got that in the, I got this other joint, this One Love joint shit. Or Troy, reminisce.
Oh, y'all come see us. Okay.
But it's ill, but it's like, there's jazz musicians in here and shit. It's John Coltrane, I think there's Mingus, Sarah Vaughan, and I think Thelonious Monk. I would have thought you'd have seen like Troy or Hev or Biggie,
right,
some of them in there.
Right. Well, yo, this week we gonna jump into a topic. You know what I mean? My man Beezo hit me a minute ago. We was chopping it up about it. Wanted to bring it on the bench, see what everybody, you know, felt about it. So, B, why don't you take it over from there?
Yeah, basically the convo was it started on somehow, I don't know what website it was on. It might have been just Facebook. And somebody, you know, I'm friends with, sent, put up a link or posted some shit. You know, it was two young girls, high school kids. I think they were like sophomores or juniors getting into a fight. And it was a link off of World Star Hip Hop. And as I'm watching it, you know, it took me to what World Star's page. And, you know, I stopped watching it. I couldn't take it no more. It was just so crazy. These two little young teenage girls fighting. I mean, this girl hooked off on this chick, something crazy. And then it's like, you see the little audience around them. People are videotaping it. There's other kids there. And nobody stops it until the one girl is like out for the count and is about to get stomped out. And then from that, it took me to like watching more clips on there. And I'm not even joking. I must have been checking clips for about an hour or so on World Star Hip Hop. And I did not come across one single music song, you know, one video about music, anything even relating to hip hop at all. Everything was fighting, you know, crazy. It was one shit on there with some dudes chilling on a call, I think in Harlem somewhere, and some cat just walked up. We shot a cat and blamed them, and they ran off and jumped in the car. That was a clip on World Star. And I was telling Kill and Vic and y'all and Ev, a couple years ago, I had to stop a fight of some high school girls. And I remember at the time, there was other adults around. It was a crowd of young kids out there. And I was all one trying to stop it. And the two things that I kept hearing that I heard vividly while I was trying to break the fight up, and I'm getting punched, kicked, scratched by these girls, is one cat told me, why he stopping? Yo, why he stopping? And somebody else in there screaming out, World Star, World Star, World Star. You know, obviously World Star Hip Hop, meaning they're going to post it on World Star Hip Hop. So basically, if my point being is that for this website to be as big as it is and be called World Star Hip Hop, it reminded me of that show we did in the beginning about Is That Hip Hop? And I'm here to call out World Star Hip Hop, man. That shit that y'all promoting, that y'all doing, that y'all pushing, that y'all eating off of, that y'all thriving off of, it's not hip-hop. And with all the bullshit hip-hop is going through, all the stigmatizations that hip-hop has kind of had to try to conquer and get past and get over, a site like World Star Hip-Hop just takes it back and it feeds into all those negative stereotypes that rich white folks and rich folks, period, you know, suburban folks, whoever it is, who look down on hip-hop, it just gives them fuel to their fire, man, in terms of, look, see, this is hip-hop. This is what they call hip-hop. Not knowing, you know, that's not hip-hop, man. It's not. It's just some knuckleheads doing knucklehead shit. But somebody like World Star Hip-Hop promotes it the way they do, there's going to be some who think that that's the standard. That's the norm. Never mind what it does to the young kids. And that's a whole other saga in and of itself. But just in terms of I mean, maybe I sound old, man. Maybe that's what it is. I'm getting old now. But one thing I learned over the years, all that shit the old timers was always talking, it just came from a place of knowledge, of having been there, done that, and having seen things. And our generation, we grew up in the crack era. You know what I mean? So we saw certain things that our parents never saw. We also grew up with the video games and the internet and all that shit is a part of our whole journey, you know what I'm saying, to where we are now as adults, which no other generation can say. Our parents' generation was before all this, you know, this technology shit that we're dealing with now. And our kids' generation, they just came in after it's already been established by us, by hip hop and by the, you know, the technological community or whatever. But we're the only ones who have seen it from the beginning to where it, you know, where it was thriving, where it was, and to where it is now. And it comes from a place of wisdom, man, having learned shit, man. And you know, World Star Hip Hop is just, it's promoting so much of the negative shit that goes on, man. It just, it creates an environment for Trayvon Martin and shit like that, man, where there'd be some ignorant white folks that, and if you look at comments on some of these shits, oh, believe me, especially if they're coming off of YouTube, there's plenty of white folks, whether they're young or not, that are looking at this like, yo, I've seen it, like calling dumb monkeys, and this is what you have, this is what you get when you get a bunch of dumb niggas. I mean, this is what they think of us sometimes. And again, my point is like, I'm calling out World Star Hip Hop for perpetuating, promoting, and basically eating off of just the crazy negative stereotypes that hip hop has been trying for decades to live down. And World Star Hip Hop just feeds into that shit, man. And I don't know if y'all feel the same way, if you know, if y'all seen the same things, but that's how I see it. And I got a real problem with that, being that I got 20-something-year-old children and I got a little young daughter who's now going to grow up in this type of environment. So it worries me. It really does.
What you say on that, Ev?
I completely agree, 100%. I've checked out, you know, World Star Hip Hop a couple times before to see what it was about when I thought it was a hip hop site and realized that it was anything but that. It was basically, I mean, I question, you know me, I always question the mind state of the person behind it and who fueled them, who, you know, who put the battery in their pack and just sent them on their way. So, I mean, my thing with World Star, I think, you know, it's one, like Beezo said, it's not a hip hop site at all. It has nothing to do with hip hop. And the fact that you're connecting violence, black violence with hip hop, is a problem. Actually, when you guys told me we were you know, talking on this topic, I actually did some research, and what I found out was, I forgive me because I can't remember the brother's name, but it's one of the brothers of Zulu Nation. I actually did an open letter to the cat who started World Star Hip Hop, whoever's the brain behind it. And not only did he do an open letter, he did a video on top of that. And he was real, you know, direct as far as saying, like, listen, you know, you need to change the title of your site, you know, change the name to worldstar.com or worldstar, whatever, but you need to take hip hop out of it because it has nothing to do with hip hop culture. And I couldn't agree with him, you know, wholeheartedly. I'm not sure when he actually sent this video. I don't know what's happened now, but I know the cat was highly upset. He was from the Zulu Nation. He was highly upset. And he was talking about, you know, like, you know, I'll see you at some point. Like, you know, he was like, yo, we will see you at some point. Like, you will get seen. So, I mean, I think, you know, whoever the cat is, regardless of, you know, what his mind frame is or what his mind state is or how much money he think he's making off of it, he's adding more poison. He's doing more harm than anything. Right. There's really, to me, there is no good. You know, if he sees the good, it's him walking away with $1 million check, and I'm sure he does. Mm-hmm. But the damage that he's doing to his own community is, you know, it's almost unrepairable. So, you know, my thing is with the cat, because I can't remember the cat's name who actually started, because I did that research too. And I'm sure, you know, whoever he is, he needs to really like take note of hip hop culture. And one thing I'm realizing now is, like, and I hate to be a little long-winded with this, but one thing I'm realizing now is there is a lack of knowledge of hip hop culture to the generation right below us, which is, I know we've talked about this before, but a lot of that is our fault. You know, I don't know if we did a proper thing as far as passing the knowledge on as far as what the culture was about and really staying tied into that, because I realize a lot of these cats don't understand the culture at all. But you want to jump into things and you're quick to call something hip hop without really understanding what hip hop really is. and what hip hop really is about. So yeah, but I mean, I agree wholeheartedly with Beezo, man. I wish the dude would just change the name. You know, if you want to promote, you want to promote ignorance, you know what I'm saying? But change your name. You and to those cats that are fans of it, you know what I mean? Like, if y'all into that, y'all into posting and watching people and you know, get knocked out and all types of violence, because all you're doing really is desensitizing yourself. Mm-hmm. So when you do really see it in the street, you won't respond because you think that's how it's supposed to be, because that's what you watch all day long. Yep. So yeah, but that's my thing with that, man. I couldn't agree more. I think Worldstar needs to be, I wish the whole site itself would just plummet and burn in hell. You know what I'm saying? For real, because I think it's just, it's not only damaging to hip hop, but it's damaging to black people or people of color, people of African descent. You know what I'm saying? I think it's just damaging all the way around. And it's not that, you know, that we're trying to hide our negative, our faults, because we have them. We all races have them. But I think it's one thing, you know, people love putting, you know, when soon as something happens negative and it's involving a black person, they love throwing it on every site, every media opportunity they can find to put it out into the world. They'll do that as if nobody else has, you know, dirty laundry. So,
you know, it's funny you sound, I'll let you speak on it real quick, yo, but it's from some, what you just said about how they'll put a name, they'll put hip hop's name to things. Go back to, I don't know if y'all remember, a couple years ago, there was a fight in a New York City club between Chris Brown and Drake, I think it was.
I heard about that.
And supposedly it was over Rihanna, and glasses and bottles were thrown, and the cat Tony Parker from the Spurs was there, and some glass caught his eye and fucked him up. He missed some of the Olympics because of this shit. But the front page of the Daily News and I believe the New York Post both said something about hip hop was in the headline. And I'm like, damn, Chris Brown is an R&B artist. Yeah, Drake, I mean, okay. We'll call him a hip hop artist, you know, for argument's sake. But is he really? Whatever. But the fact that just because there was a fight between two young music entertainers, they just immediately labeled it a hip hop fight, hip hop brawl in a nightclub. So that's like, that's what I'm saying. They feeding into that shit, man. And they warping these young kids' minds to thinking like, yo, this is what we do. This is how we get down. And it's okay. Just videotape it if you're there and put it on World Star Hip Hop. That's all.
Yeah, I mean, you know, for me, I agree with both of y'all. I think, I don't know the history of the site. I know just the history of the internet and how fast it grew that maybe, and again, I don't know, I'm just assuming, like, maybe it started off as a hip-hop website, because I've seen stuff like this happen before, where it's like, you know, when the whole blogger thing came out, it was like, yo, I can do my own website or whatever, and maybe it started as World Star Hip-Hop, like, yo, I'm playing hip-hop videos, and then just as technology changed, you know, I mean, as soon as you got camera phones and now you got videos on your phones, you know, as that stuff changed, and I'm sure people submitting videos to them, you know, and that money started coming in with the sponsorships. It's kind of just like with anything else with hip hop. Like, it started off like this, but then it just goes, you know, sideways when money comes into play. You know what I mean? So, I mean, I wholeheartedly agree with both of y'all, you know, take the word hip hop out because it has nothing to do with hip hop. But I'm just thinking maybe that's where it started from, because I've seen other websites that are, you know, on some old, you know, strictly hip hop, or, you know, look at Hot 97, the place where hip hop lives. You know, that's where it started from. And now the biggest complaint is you can't hear no real hip hop on Hot 97. So, you know, it seems like stuff always starts off on a good note, but once money, you know, becomes involved and everything like that, you know, it all just falls apart. And I think the hard part is that, like I said, just with technology, that, I mean, I'm sure growing up in our day, Ev, I mean, you know, growing down there in Philly where everybody would get robbed, I'm sure if in the 90s and the late 80s cats had camera phones and videotapes on their phones, there'd be plenty of stuff. Many robberies, you know, I'm sure in Mount Vernon, New York, Brooklyn, all over, you know, would have been publicized. But just at that time, we didn't have that technology. So, you know, you're right. Every time I go to work, if something happens in the hood, you know, like, oh, Mr. Kill, this happened this week. And I'd be like, where are they? Like, yeah, you want to see that videotape? Like, it's just, it's almost just like, you know, Beezo, if I'm watching TV and I see classic, you know, college basketball game, I hit record on a DVR. That's how, you know, these kids' minds are set that The second a fight breaks out, the second anything stupid wild, you know, happens, you gotta grab your phone. You know, you gotta get your picture of it. You gotta get your videotape of it. And now that we got these Vine, you know, videos, and now Instagram got videos, and you know, so I just think, like, you know, when you're able to go on any website for that matter and see somebody get killed, like, that's just over the top, man. And you know what I mean? Like, with, you know, the young teen who got killed in Chicago a couple of years back. I mean, the fact that this is on YouTube on any video channel, you know, and it's like, Ev, like you said, like, you just become so desensitized to it and to our teens, that's just what they do. You know, that's the first thing. And the worst part is the technology just keeps getting better. I'm looking at the new Galaxy S5. You got a cell phone recording in 1080p now. You know what I mean? You know, you got cell phones that's up to 18 megapixels. You know, so I think everybody with Twitter, with everything, everybody feels like they're the reporter now. You know what I mean? They feel like they have to report. I remember when that plane landed on the Hudson in New York. I think the first person who put that out was somebody on their Twitter. You know, before CNN had it, before, you know, any other news station had it, it was reported on Twitter. You know, so I agree with both y'all. I don't know, you know, what we could do, because the hard part is, I'm sure we're the minority, so we could, you know, ban it or boycott it, but, you know, the majority of the people, that this is what they love. They're uploading their videos, hoping it'll get on, and then telling their friends to do it and get on. And, you know, we live in a like society, whether it's Facebook likes or how many followers you got on Instagram or Twitter. This is how my kids talk to each other. It's like, how many Instagram followers you got? You only got 300? You whack. You got to get your game up to at least 2,000. You know what I mean? So it's just the day and times that we live in it. But I wholeheartedly agree with y'all. But what do you, Beezo, I know you spoke on it, you touched on it a little bit. What do you specifically feel like this is doing to the kids?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that, because that was going to be my point. That I think it's two things, and it's not just to the kids, but I think it speaks to society. And I might be a little long-winded, but I'll try to be as quick as possible. But I remember a number of years back when I was in Baltimore, and I was on the way to pick up my son from the babysitter with two of my peoples in the car, and we saw this garbage truck with about four or five cats in it crash and flip over and all that shit. Oil was spitting out the bottom of it, and we jumped out of my car. And mind you, back then I was always driving dirty. I had no license and nothing, so any stop by the police and it was a wrap for all three of us. But we stopped, ran out the car, ran up there, jumped on top of the truck, pulling these dudes out. And as we're helping everybody, we're helping these cats, you see a crowd of people just watching. Now, this is before all of this, you know, taking cameras and cell phones and all that shit. But if that was then, if that was now, all those people would have been out there videotaping it. And it just makes me, that's one of the things that scares me about all this, is like, people are more quick to reach in their pocket and pull out their phone than to go help the person. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? It's like, yo, how about before you doing that? And, you know, I always get upset when I see people are like, you know, you going to your kid's recital or some shit, and you see the person in the back doing this, watching the whole thing on their camera. It's like, you missing real life. You know what I'm saying? You so caught up in trying to record it and put it out there for the world to see. What about you? You're missing the point. Something's taking place that either you're missing something that you could be a big part of, or you're missing something that you can help somebody in that's in need of help. But you want to be so quick to be the first, like you said, everybody wants to be the reporter. They want to be the CNN or they neighborhood or they friends or whatever. So people are more concerned with that. Now, in terms of the children, I think what happens is, and this is what I got from that day, the more clips I watched, it seemed like, for one, they don't have any, you know, like an 18-year-old to watch this video and that type of thing, whatever, whatever. There doesn't seem to be any filtering on their site in terms of the graphic violence and even nudity and shit like that. So, and not to mention the age of the people who are in the video committing the acts of violence. There's a number of them, but these are early, you know, 15, 16, 17, or underage children, and they're being recorded, and WorldStar is putting it on their site. Now, I may not know the law like that, but granted, if it's some sexual, then obviously, yeah, but I would think that violent acts, that you can't be promoting them shits, posting them for these people that are 15, 16 years old, because the more 15, 16-year-olds see this is what's going on in everybody else's hood, it ain't going on in my hood, then these kids start wanting, everybody wants to outdo the next one. That's how young people are. That's, I'm sure all three of us, you know, times we were younger in our teenage years, some of the stuff you might have gotten into was on the strength of, well, everybody else is doing it, you know what I'm saying? I ain't trying to be the sucker, blah, blah. You know, you do things for the wrong reasons at times when you're in that age. You do them to impress other people and to get respect and to be that dude and all that. And I think what WorldStar does, it just promotes that ignorance, man. And it just, like you said, you're saturizing the kids' minds. You're making them numb to the fact that what I'm seeing and what I'm partaking in is wrong, man. And it bothers me because I remember a fight in front of my crib in high school, and one of the most notorious, wildest cats in the Vernon, I'm not going to say his name, but the cat just happened to be walking by when the fight was going on, and he breaking it up. And he heard some of us like, oh, let him fight. And he turned to us and grabbed us up like, listen here, little nigga, y'all need to chill with all this, and started breaking it down for us. And this was a hood cat. This was a wild ass boy. You know what I mean? He was a straight hood, wild nigga. And he knew that, yo, y'all cats too young to be out here fighting, man. And it's come from that to where we at now, where WorldStar can put a 14-year-old girl getting knocked unconscious by a 15-year-old girl who claims to be a best friend over some boy? It's like, come on, man. How are you promoting this? There has to be some types of checks and balances that should be in place, man. Whether it's just in age content, you know, where there's filtering for you have to be 18. You got to age verification and shit like that. And, you know, never mind the parents. I mean, I'm not even going to touch on that. That's a whole other side of the issue. But when you have a lack of proper parenting around you and the kids are left to their own devices and the parents are not in tune with what their kids are partaking in, and this is what they're seeing, this is what they're partaking in on a regular basis, that's what you're going to get, man. Just more and more and more ignorance stepped up to another level, you know what I'm saying, because everybody's trying to outdo each other. So that's my two biggest concerns is for the kids, man, in terms of where it's taking them mentally, man. You know what I'm saying? How it's leaving, the impression it's leaving on them in terms of what is supposed to be going on around them. You know what I mean? They see enough of it on their own, but they then jump online and see, oh, this is going on everywhere. Oh, okay. And then everybody wants to partake. Everybody wants to be a part of the violence, man. And I think that's what's really going to happen. It is happening, but I think that's the end all be all for that site, because I don't know what else could be their motive, y'all.
And to add on to that, man, I just want to, I'll try to make it quick, but just a couple of points to jump off what Beezo was saying. If you look at it, man, WorldStar Hip Hop, I'm sure, gets a couple of million views, easy. So when you at that level, you move up to a certain, you move up into a whole another bracket. Mm-hmm. And if I put up a video on YouTube or on Vimeo that has Michael Jackson playing underneath it, they'll know it and take it down. Exactly. So if that's the case, why aren't these same people taking note of what's going on in WorldStar Hip Hop? And I know that they are, but why aren't they saying anything? Why is that? So you ask yourself this question, why is that allowed to slip through?
Because it's funny you say that. It's funny you say that, because I was while we were talking, I was looking on just on Wikipedia or whatever, and it's saying it's an American hip hop site, shock site, and content aggregating video blog created in 2005, averages 1.1 million unique visitors a day, and it ranks 247th in site traffic in the U.S. and 983 for the world, worldwide traffic. And it's actually a cat from Queens, from Hollis, Queens.
Yeah, and that just to me, that goes to prove, like, you know, that y'all know what's going on, y'all know what's being played, but at the same point in time, you're encouraging it and you're letting it pass through. So, you know, we really gotta ask yourself the question. We already know the answers to it. You know, it's not rocket science. But my thing is just that, like, you know, and like Beezo said, there's no filters. There's no, you know, you gotta be over 18. There's no, like, you know, this. I mean, and the same cast that's working for the joint, they know what type of content is going up there. They know what's being put up on the site. So, you know, so everybody gets the check and everybody just turns their head and act like it's all good. It's kind of crazy. It's scary that this can happen in today's time. And another thing to add on, not to jump around, but the whole idea of when something happens, we always, you know, see people and they're quick to throw up a phone. When I see certain videos, man, there's a certain type of ignorance going on, I'm immediately upset with the person that's taking the video.
Right.
I've seen this one video of the sister. She was in the market, and she had two kids, and she obviously didn't have control over kids. I think the son was like, she was fighting the son or fighting the daughter or something.
Yeah.
And it's a grown man. Instead of him going in to break it up, he's mm-hmm. got the video joint up and talking about what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, so we don't, you know, we don't, what happened to, we're not community no more. We don't, you know what I mean? We don't, when you see ignorance, we just turn our head, act like it's not there. I think it's crazy. It's crazy, and it's a little scary to see, like, where the people, and it's not even the young people, because this was the old cat that was videotaping this joint. Mm-hmm. He was an older man.
Yeah, he was following him around the store.
Following him around the whole store just to have him. It's like, yo, you're a grown man, and you showing a video trying to show their ignorance, but I'm looking at you as you're ignorant. Because you're going to sit there and videotape that as if it's cool, so you can put it up on WorldStar or whoever you put it up on. I don't know, man.
Hey, yo.
I don't know.
Yeah, but I feel you, Evan. I think, like you said, that's a great point you brought up about Vimeo and YouTube if you're playing somebody's music. But again, that you know why that happens? Because somebody's losing money. You know, that's what it all comes down to. You know, if you're playing a Michael Jackson song, whoever owns it wants a piece of that. And if you ain't paying for it, but, you know, so it all comes down to money. You know what I mean? So it's a sad thing. And like you said, I mean, it's happened. I always compare the internet now and these blog sites to just like the radio, how the radio used to be. You know what I mean? At the end of the day, the same complaints you heard about the radio, I turn on this station, you hear the same song, same thing with blogs. You go to 8 different hip hop blogs, and I swear to you, they all look the same. Sometimes they even got the song, you know, the post in the same order almost. You know what I mean? So it's literally like the internet has just mirrored what the radio game did. So like I said, the same way people are like, yo, how does Hot 97 allow this music to get played, or how does Power 99 allow this music to get played, and what it's doing to the young people, and this ain't real music, and this is the same complaints we're now having about, you know, the internet, these blogs, these video sites. And I remember, when I did a video for Fnatic, and I reached out to WorldStar just about trying to get it up on there. They was like, yo, if you ain't got 100,000 views on YouTube or something like that, like, it's a G to get it up. You know what I mean?
That's what I was going to ask you about, because that's what's troubling to me, because I'm like, how would these kids, like, I'm going to keep going back to that one video. That's where it started for me, with the two young girls. Like, it's another young girl videotaping one of their friends, classmates, whatever. And if that's the case, like what you just said, because it went, for as far as I understand, I mean, you can hear people while the shit's going on, WorldStar. It's like, do they post it on YouTube? Does it have to go to YouTube first? Or I just don't get it, because I refuse to believe that these young girls had a G to put it on WorldStar, you know what I'm saying? But it's like, if they're not putting it directly on WorldStar, how was it getting 100,000 views to get on WorldStar in the first place?
Nah, I don't know all the rules, but I think, just off the top of my head, I would assume all that ignorant stuff is going to get the views. So right. If you send a joint in with somebody getting knocked out, right. Oh, yeah, we going to post that. Oh, this is just a regular music video? Like, no, nobody gets shot, nobody died, nobody. You mean you just bought some, your man is just rapping over a beat? Oh, nah.
Yes, you did a snuff film with K rhyming over the shit.
Right.
Okay, no
problem. But it just being a regular video, oh nah, B, you gotta be at least 100,000 on YouTube or
right. But it is WorldStar Hip Hop. So if you have a hip hop video that you wanna put on there, if it ain't got the 100,000 views on YouTube, you gotta pay a G to get it on WorldStar Hip Hop.
Right.
If I walk onto your set right now, Kel, and just snuff you and record that, I can get that shit on WorldStar immediately. I just got to put, like,
no one problem.
Of my beats underneath it, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is the knockout blow. Bow, you know, right when the kick drops or something. That shit will get on there.
Right.
But just me and you doing some good music, we got to pay.
I mean, it's the same thing. Like I said, it just mirrors the radio game from, you know, trying to, you know, get your joint on Hot 97 back in the day. It's like, yo, you got to have some payola. You know, you got to pay to play. I mean, that's the moral to the story. And that's my beef with so many of these hip-hop sites that 9 times out of 10, like I said, started out just like the three of us saying, yo, you know, back in 2004, 2005 when blogs jumped off, yo, we should do a writer's bench blog, and yo, we just gonna talk about hip hop, and we gonna post hip hop and independent artists and stuff like that. And then the money start coming in, and it's like, oh, well, you know, Talib Kweli want to post this joint. All right, well, tell Talib, you know, give us $2,000. You know, once that money comes into play, man, it messes up everything. So it messed up the radio. You know, then for a while, Cash was like, yo, fuck the radio. We don't need the radio. We going to go to the internet. But now it's the same thing, dog. I've reached out to plenty of blogs about posting stuff, and it's like, again, you got to pay to play. You know what I mean? And it's sad because, again, it probably started from a place of, this is a place where we just want to promote good hip hop. But as money comes into play, you know, it becomes, you know, it's hard to turn down them. I'll never forget the story, man. It was bad. I don't know if y'all remember Mike Geronimo, his second album, he had this song called Making Moves with Puff. Mm-hmm. And I mean, it was horrible. I mean, yes. Coming off of Master IC and, you know, Shit Is Real, like, this was maybe one of the most blatant sellout songs I had ever seen. And I remember Ray telling me the story of I think it was Flex, or somebody captured, like, yo, that's whack, we ain't playing it. And the people from the label was like, yo, if you play this, like, or some old, like, we'll give you, like, 2 tickets to, like, Jamaica for a week. Like, I mean, payola, and this is back in 97. So, I mean, you could only imagine what payola, and if I'm not mistaken, I saw something, I think this was the president of BET or somebody from BET actually finally coming out and admitting that all these years they have been taking payola for this BS that's on, you know, BET, you know. So again, it just comes down to, you know, it was just the radio and the television, now it's the net, you know. So just as much as, you know, at one point in time, I remember BET being Rap City. And seeing rap videos. And I remember it being video sold with Donnie Simpson and good interviews going on and stuff like that. And, you know, now you turn on, you know, BET and half the time you can't even see videos. You know what I'm saying? Same thing with MTV. Same thing with VH1. You know, you got VH1 probably got more television program with reality shows than they, I don't even know if they play videos.
Yeah, I'm about to say, do they even do videos anymore at all? I don't think they do.
I don't even know. But again, started off real good. Started off as, this is going to be a place where we can show videos and boom, boom, boom. And as time and as money comes on, because I'm telling you, VH1 ain't never going back. The money they get from these basketball wives and loving hip hop and all that stuff, they ain't going back. They ain't never going back to video, man, because there ain't no money in the films. So,
you it's know. Sad, man. It's sad when you say that, because I mean, you're right. You're 150% right, man. But it's like, yo, there's no money in positive shit. Or not even, I shouldn't even say that. It's that there's so much money in the negative shit, in promoting the negative shit. You look at even in sports, kid, but like, you don't hear a story. You'll hear, like, once in a blue, you know, every now you hear a sentimental good story about some athlete and something he's doing or whatever, whatever. But 90% of the time, the story is about some negative shit, you know, some locker room altercation, something, you know, all this other bullshit. That's what sells, you know, back then at least, sells newspapers, sells magazines. It's all a negative shit, man. And I think it speaks to a much larger issue, as in a lot of these things that's wrong with hip-hop do speak to a much larger social issue. But, you know, we right here feeling the effects of what it's done to hip-hop. Because, again, we're from that generation where we saw it from its inception to, you know, where it is now, that we've seen it, you know, going a roller coaster ride and, you know, trying to make a name for itself, finally making it, you know, riding and then having this drop off and talent and then come back up. It's been a big roller coaster ride for hip hop, but I don't honestly, it's things like this that make me say things like, I don't see hip hop ever coming back to what it once was. Because it's like, it was a time in the 90s where it was like, it was really just the music that had to come back. You know what I mean? You just had to get better music from the artists. Cats were starting to make money, but they weren't millionaires like that. But now it's so much peripheral stuff that play a hand in the music, man, and play a part in the artists that are signed, the type of music that they put on the radio, the type of videos that they do, what videos get played. There's so many levels to the BS, and a place like World Star Hip Hop is one of those levels that it's like that train is going so far down the tracks, man, and it's got so much steam behind it. Is there ever going to be a time where it's going to even slow down, let alone stop? I honestly don't think so, man. And it bothers me to say that. I really don't think it will.
I mean, I really think, when I think about these things and we talk about money, I think in a sense we're, you know, not all of us, but I think a lot of people are still trying to do that whole keep up with the Joneses thing. And because if you're not trying to become a millionaire or something, you can still find a certain level of life comfortability.
Right.
It doesn't mean that you got to sell your soul to have the, you know, 8 cars and 3 houses. You know what I'm saying? And I think, you know, there's a level of comfortability in doing what you love to do and keeping some integrity about it. But I think, you know, they just got so many people that really want to, you know, pop bottles and do whatever they think that, you know, success is. I think people's levels of success are a bit jaded. And if you think, if you reevaluate what is success for you, what's successful for you may not necessarily be successful for somebody else. But, you know, if your level of success is, I want to have a house, I want to have a car, I want to have my family set and cool, and we just be comfortable. I said nothing in that about being rich. I said nothing about having a mansion. I said nothing about having a Jaguar or, you know, certainly. I think if we reassess what we need, as opposed to trying to be like this person and that person and this person over there, then we probably would sell ourselves. We would do a lot less selling our souls and selling our culture, as opposed to really just making what's right, what we feel is what we feel we can survive off of, what we feel is good for, you know, good for our community. But that's, you know, maybe sometimes I can be a little too like radical in that thinking, but I think, you know, we really got to reevaluate what our levels of success are.
You know what, Ev, though, that's crazy you got to say that, because thinking wanted to live righteously and positively. And that's radical thinking. It's like, damn, what does that say for hip hop and the world at large, when intelligence and a desire to just live righteously and live and not be concerned with being well off? Like you said, my success is, I got 4 beautiful children that love me to death. I got my wife who loves me to death. I got good friends. I got family that I'm close with, I'm tight with, even through the bumps and downs with friends and family. I can look back and every day I can count my blessings.
Mm-hmm.
And it's funny because I have all these material things. You know, I have a car. I had nice shoes and clothes and this and that. But when I start taking stock of the things I've been blessed with in my life, true blessings, now one of them is some material object that I can go back out and repurchase it or buy it over. It's right. Just, it's something that connects to me as a species, as a human being. It connects to my soul. It doesn't connect to my body, you know what I mean? It fits on my finger, around my waist, around my wrist. No. It wraps around my soul. It's a part of the essence of who I am. It's these people and these things that are around me that are tangible, they're real. And man, I'm going off on a tangent, but it's like, that's kind of sad and scary, man. That it's considered, you were considered radical thinking to look at your success as being successful at life, you know what I'm saying? In terms of just love, peace, and happiness. I mean, that's what it's really about. But damn, yo, damn, what does that really say about society, man, and hip-hop too, man? Because at least hip-hop came from a place of kind of getting shit off your chest. It's like, you know, modern-day blues music, you know what I mean, where it's about the struggle and learning a part about, you know, a part of society that was, you know, hidden from the rest of the world. And here it is now. We've let the world see what it is, and now we've let the world come in and put it in a box, rejigger it, and present it as they want it to be presented.
Exactly.
You know, it's sad, man. It is. It really is. It's sad.
Yeah, I think the hard part, too, is like you said, of just trying to think that way and it being radical, is that you got a lot of people that at this point in time, and I think Beezo or somebody said it here on one of the other shows, where we were talking about, like, kids were raised in that get money era. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, we at least had the Run DMC era. We had the cool era. You know, the era where, you know, Run DMC was the hardest group on the planet, and they never talked about shooting or killing or selling drugs or nothing like that. Where so many of these kids nowadays, they were born in that era of get money. Like, that was their foundation. And it's like, their foundation of hip-hop was just get money. And like with anything, I mean, your foundation is going to be what everything else is built for. You know, so our generation, this generation nowadays is, you know, big on, you know, get money. I mean, I won't hold you. Our generation was big on get money. I remember them get jiggy parties for Morgan and Cat's talking about they ain't gonna pay their rent this month to get them out of Cristal to front at the club, or, you know, I'm gonna, you know, do this to, you know, take out this student loan and flip it and get a car. You know what I mean? Like, so every generation has done it. I just think that this generation is just multiplied it by whatever we had to go through times 100. And it is all about getting money right now. You know what I mean? It, you know, it sounds good to say, and I mean, I'll be the first to admit it, just turning 40. I don't need to be successful. I don't need 50 cars and all that stuff, but I do want to have some money in my pocket. You know what I mean?
What's wrong with that? I mean, that's what...
I just know a lot of times people, you know, that... But like you said, Ev, it's not about... I don't think nowadays people take selling their soul. I think selling your soul now is so much easier done than it's ever been. You know, maybe back in the 60s, before you signed a dude to a messed up record deal, maybe you thought for a second, like, should I really... I just think your soul is not important anymore to people. You know what I mean? I think we're living
in the morals.
It's like stock is going down on souls and the price of souls, yo.
It's like they're not as important nowadays, and more important. And like you guys said, from these videos, people are becoming desensitized to death. One time, this was a couple of years ago, in one of my community centers, the girls were playing spades, and they was like, yeah, you know, such got killed last night. Like, yeah, that's messed up. All right, you know, boom, there's the big joke. And I was just like, whoa, like, that's it? Like, one of your homeboys got killed, and, it, you know, that's just it? I mean, going back to 2000, when I first started working with kids, I'll never forget this game that these kids would play. They would be like, all right, who's going to be it? And they'd be like, all right, me. And then they'd act like there were some gunshots, and then one of them would fall, and then one of them would be the mother, like, oh, they done killed my baby. They done killed my baby. And then all the rest of the kids would come out and go through his pockets. And this was a game they was playing in 2000 in Southeast.
How old was these kids?
Oh, man, this was elementary school. This was elementary school. So this was probably, around like fifth or sixth graders. Maybe like fourth is like what, six, seven, eight, like eight to 11
years. Let me ask you this, Kill. Oh my God, that's wow, yo. I mean,
keep in mind what I'm saying. This is 2000, so this is 14.
This before even right before we've gotten to the level it's at now. But
this is before WorldStar, this is before smartphones. This is before all that, and this is the game that they was playing.
That's a game they played.
I'm
just curious if they know, and it's like, it's sad because that is a routine that they've seen play out with before their very eyes. You know what I mean? Obviously, kid getting shot, mother coming out, people going through his problems. They've seen it, so that's how they know it. So I'm just wondering, like, you know, again, going back to our childhoods and stuff, I mean, yeah, I've seen fights, you know, guy get knocked out and people went up and were going through their pockets. I mean, shit, I've done that myself. But I'm just wondering, I'm trying to think of a scenario that it's more positive that you would know at that age, that I'm wondering, like, damn, do they know that as well as they know this game? You know what I mean? Do they know, like, fucking just run, catch, and kiss? You know what I'm saying? As well as they know that game and shit?
I can't keep saying it enough that this was 2000. You know what I mean? That my kids were, you know, I'll never forget one of my kids. So one of my tutors, man, and I just laughed to keep crying. I don't want nobody in TV land to be like, oh, kill this, you know. But I've become desensitized to it because I've heard it so much over the 14 years I've been working with kids. But one of my tutors was there, and one of my boys, he was like probably like 10. He was like, yo, I want to get you something for Christmas. And she was like, what you going to get me? He was like, dead. Like, yo, it is just like, and it was said with no like, let me sneak and say it. It was like back in the day with like the Chronic, like, yo, you get that, what, these nuts? Like, it was not no, let me try to slip this in and nobody hear me. It was like, that's what I want to give them. You know, so again, and to answer your question, no, these are the games that my kids will play. And then as soon as they would go through his pockets, they'd be like, all right, let's play again. Who want to be it? So this was like literally like for us playing freeze tag, their freeze tag was, let's play who got shot. You know, that's so true. It's just, you know, so again, when you're growing up in that era, then you throw, that's just the violence in your neighborhood, then you throw in the music, now you throw this in. I mean, you know, I don't know if it's a thing about hip-hop coming back. I don't think community can come back. I think community has left the building, and that it's Elvis has left the building, and Community is not coming back, because I'm the only person like, yo, chill with that game. Like, yo, we ain't playing that. Like, oh, come on, Mr. Kill, you know that? And I'm just like, nah, you know, so, but, and I can't stress it enough that the game has gotten much worse in the last 14 years, you know, from 2000. So, just...
You know, I'm sorry, Kill, let me ask you something, though, because that shit keeps running through my head, man, picturing these kids playing this game, yo. It's like, did you sense at all that they understand, like, how crazy that shit is? That this is a game to them?
I mean, I don't think they understand it, because at the end of the day, what I've realized with my kids and this generation of kids is that they're making out their bucket list of 12. Because they're like, yo, nobody lives really longer than 18 in my neighborhood. So when I'm kicking it with my kids, it's like, well, I do this because I'm going to die in 4 years. So it's the same way as if one of us got the phone call like, yo, you got cancer, you got a year to live, and we start doing all the stuff we always wanted to do, skydive, ride an elephant, Africa, do all the crazy stuff we always wanted to do. These kids are doing that now. So it's like, I talk to my shorties and they'll be like, well, I'm pregnant because I want to have kids, you know, and in their mind, they're like, I'm not going to live past this age, so I got to hurry up and do it now. I'm going to steal cars, or I'm going to sell drugs, or I'm going to do all these crazy things that they're literally, you know, making out their bucket list, you know, right now. And that's a reason why so much they're making these decisions. They're not making decisions thinking, okay, what is my life going to be like in 20 years? They're making decisions off of what their life is going to, it's like right now, and 9 times out of 10, with it ending soon, I want to have some fun. So I think that's where their mindset was then. That's where it is now. So
that's really sad, man. That truly is it's almost depressing, man. As a parent of 4, 2 boys, 2 girls, man, and yo, that's pretty fucked up, man. That is pretty fucked up, because it's like, I mean, I think back to my teenage years when I had a, you know, it was never like a ready to die attitude. It was a, you know, you kind of might have a I don't give a fuck attitude on some levels, but for me personally, it did get to a point where I found myself in a situation and in a place where it was like, okay, hold up. Now, I've gone too far. I don't need a parent or an adult to tell me, yo, you fucking up now. Get your shit together. It was like, okay, it's clear enough to me. You know what I'm saying? And I got to take care. I got to take a hold of my life again, get it back on course. And I remember my counselor in high school, you know, telling me, you're going to end up in 1 of 3 places. Dead, in jail, or on the streets. And I'm like, damn, that's it? That's what you think of me? He's like, well, look at what you're doing. Then she started running down the laundry list, and she started pulling out all these statistics and this and that and numbers and whatnot. And I don't know if it was her intentions, but it did make me start taking a deeper look at myself, like, damn, B, you was raised to be better than this. You know what I'm saying? And, like, that shit would really hurt my grandparents and shit like that. Like, you know, I had a sense of morals, I guess is the word, man, and sensibility still, but it just sounds like these kids' moral compass is just off course, doesn't exist, and man, I can't put it on them. It's obviously partly their environment and their parents as well, but I mean, damn, yo, what do you tell a child that feels like, well, I might as well just go for broke right now at the age of 13, 14, because hey, statistics say I'm not going to be here but for another 4 or 5 years, so fuck it. I might as well get it all in now. I mean, that's really fucking scary, man.